Good morning, and welcome to St. John's by the Sea Service of Morning Prayer for September 13th, 2020. Let us prepare our hearts for worship.
The same, and he must win the battle. Thus says the High and Lofty One,
who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy.
I dwell in the high and holy place,
with him who has a contrite and humble spirit,
to revive the spirit of the humble,
and to revive the hearts of the contrite ones.
Let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God, saying, Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. We have left undone those things which he ought to have done, and we have done those things which he ought not to have done, and there is no health in us. But you, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare those, O God, who confess their faults. Restore those who are penitent, according to your promises declared unto mankind, in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desires not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, has given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardons and absolves all those who truly repent and genuinely believe his holy gospel. Wherefore, let us beg him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The first lesson is taken from the sixth chapter of the book of the prophet Micah, beginning at the first verse.
Hear what the Lord says. Arise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the indictment of the Lord, and you enduring fountains of the earth. For the Lord has an indictment against his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of slavery. And I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember what Balak, king of Moab, devised, and what Balaam, the son of Beor, answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the righteous acts of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with tens thousands of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has shown you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
There is no want if we fear him.
The second lesson is taken from the 5th chapter of St. Paul's Epistle to the Galatians, beginning at the 16th verse.
But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other to keep you from doing the things you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us now recite our profession of faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
This morning we look at the topic of what it is to walk like a disciple. What the Lord has shown us in the scriptures, what is the life of a Christian? How do we show our light to the world? And basically, what it means to walk by the Spirit. And now let the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. The farmer was teaching his young son how to plow. And as the son sat on the tractor seat, his dad pointed to the far end of the field. Now, son, he said, what you have to do is keep your eyes on one point at the far end of the field. Just focus on that one thing and drive straight towards it. And when you get to the other side of the field, your row will be as straight as an arrow. Do you understand? The boy nodded in agreement. Just keep my eyes on one thing and drive towards it. Got it, Dad. So the boy started up his tractor. He looked keenly at the far end of the field, his eyes fixed on something, and the tractor began to roll down the length of the field.
He was plowing a perfectly straight row. Dad felt a swell of pride in his heart. But then, about halfway down the field, the tractor started to veer to the left. And not just a little bit. The boy was plowing way off course, and by the time he reached the other end of the field, he was completely off. Dad couldn't believe it. How could his son have failed so miserably? He threw his hat on the ground in disgust and ran to the far side of the field. Son, I told you to keep your eyes on one thing and drive straight at it. What happened?
I did, Dad. I was watching a cow in the next pasture. Then she started to walk towards that tree over there. But I just kept following her like you told me to.
So, most of us, of course, don't have experience with plowing fields. About the closest we can come to it is mowing lawns, but we live in a world, and we can certainly associate this, that wants to throw us off, to distract us, to keep us from having our eyes on the prize for which God has called us. The past two Sundays, as we have moved through Galatians, we have seen St. Paul again and again emphasize the role of the law in showing us our sin, and the role of grace in our redemption. This Sunday, still the same Paul, still the same letter, he sounds a little bit different, as though we are joining him partway through a conversation. Chapter 5 begins with another lesson concerning grace and law. But then Paul shifts his focus completely to the question of how do we, now that we are redeemed, the redeemed of Christ, live under grace. Verse 13 begins his challenge to us. You are called to freedom, brothers. Now he's talking here about freedom from the law. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity to indulge your flesh, but through love serve one another. In verse 16 of chapter 5, Paul says, walk in the Spirit and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. But how can I do that? Is it some sort of magic? And the imagination of some Christians can run wild and produce many books when they think about what it means to walk in the Spirit. And it is quite simple, because Paul lays it out right here. They imagine that being spiritual means that one must be in communication with a world that we cannot see, hear words that others cannot hear, spoken by beings from another dimension. Now, you've probably heard of cults that have started this way, with a man who hears a voice, God speaking to him alone. Now, I do believe that God does give us insight into his will, and especially when we pray. I do believe that the Holy Spirit assists us in solving all sorts of problems, and that God is behind our best aha moments when we suddenly see a better way of doing things and arranging our lives. So I am not denying that God assists us, but I am saying that Paul and the other writers of scriptures warn us that there are both people and behaviors which will pull us away from following God and seem to many to be fulfilling as they gratify the desires of the flesh. Gratifying the desires of the flesh in our brains sometimes seems this is what is good. And it's usually the topic of most books and TV shows and movies that you could watch. But for the most part, the guesswork is taken out of discerning the spirits, living by the Spirit, by a simple test that Jesus and Paul both give us. The fruit test. Matthew 7:16, Jesus says to his disciples, by their fruits you shall know them. The reading from Galatians, which begins with the words, walk in the Spirit, were not some mystical babblings by Paul with no relation to reality. He wasn't carrying on some conversation with the spirit world, kind of like fortune tellers do.
But Paul had the words of Jesus in mind when he wrote, "Walk in the Spirit," because of what he says next. And how do I know this? It's not by some spirit whispering in my ear, but by simply heeding what Paul wrote and comparing what Paul wrote with Jesus' words. Paul finishes his admonition to walk in the Spirit by showing us how. He shows us what it means by quoting the words of Jesus, "By their fruits you shall know them." And he gives for us the fruits that result from a life of walking in the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. He continues on, "Against such there is no law, and those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires." We can simply take our spiritual temperature by asking ourselves, am I producing these fruits by doing the activities, by living the life which I am living? Or is it more to satisfy the flesh? Today's Old Testament reading would have fit in well last week also with last week's gospel lesson from Luke 10:25. And hopefully you remember, this was a Good Samaritan. And the parable was set up by a lawyer who was testing Jesus, asking him, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" His mind was set on grabbing it by his effort. Micah asks a similar question this week, although it is very rhetorical, just like the lawyer asked last week. What does God want me to do? In verse 6 of chapter 6, "With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul?" Again, this is a rhetorical question. He knows the answer, and he knows none of these would please God. But questions which show us once again our need for the gospel. The point is, none of those sacrifices can save us. We can't earn our salvation by piling up as many treasures and giving them to God as we possibly could. None of that makes us right before God. So the question is, what does the Lord require? Verse 8, chapter 6. "He has told you, O man, what is good, and what the Lord requires of you, to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God." Christian spirituality begins in an unseen place, in our hearts and our minds and our souls. Spirituality is being the means by which the human spirit finds the kingdom of God, eternal life, and the Spirit of God. To be spiritual, one must love God with all our heart, with all our strength, and with all our soul. This is, of course, where we have some problems. We struggle with this, which is why it is not us, but the Holy Spirit within us who we need to let us lead our lives, not seeking to gratify ourselves, but letting God show us how to follow him. These fruits of the Spirit will then be manifest in our lives. The love, the joy, the peace, patience. These fruits are the sign of a mature Christian. And they are even visible to the world. This is why the world so actively tries to poke their eyes out so they can't see as they shout, "There is no good," and yet at the same time tell us how good they are. and being kind to others, we are told that at times we are showing kindness to angels and don't even know it. Hebrews 13:2. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unaware. And another hard part, another sign that we are walking in the Spirit, the hardest one maybe, is to warn the world of their sin. Both in the Old Testament prophets and Christ, as he teaches his apostles, he talks about the day of visitation by God, the judgment day, in the same context as he talks about our spiritual behavior. How does one walk in the Spirit? By being patient with others, kindly, while at the same time walking humbly with God, mindful that he visits us. We are not showing kindness, which is a fruit of the Spirit, if we fail to warn those around us who are not walking in the Spirit that there is a God. Different people, of course, require different approaches. But for all, a day of judgment, a day of visitation is coming. There are many churches today that don't even want to talk about sin, the need for Christ's righteousness, or certainly judgment day. These are definitely not topics which make people feel good about themselves, and I would think the topic of hell is probably in many people's minds the least accepting, inviting topic that you could choose to speak on. St. Peter in 1 Peter 2 verse 12 tells us, maintain good conduct among the non-Christians so that, though they now malign you as wrongdoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God when he appears on the day of judgment. That's pretty amazing. So in producing fruit, one of the fruits that will be seen is that at the last day, those wrongdoers will have been moved by seeing our fruit and be among those who glorify God rather than continue in their way. And that honestly seems to be something that in today's culture may seem impossible. Christian spirituality is more than just prayer and meditation. It is living a holy life. And by that, I mean a life dedicated to God's service, where the fruit of the Spirit is shown by kindly words and virtuous living. With that in mind, I'll close with what St. Paul said at the beginning of Romans chapter 12. Therefore, I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice, acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. Let us pray. Lord, we pray that we will give up trying by our own strength and to trust in you and the guiding of your Holy Spirit. Help us, Lord, that through your Holy Spirit, fruit may be produced in our lives, that the world may see it and glorify you, that by our words and actions, your gospel may be proclaimed. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Jesus was a friend for sinners. Jesus, lover of my soul. Friends may fail me, foes assail me. He, my Savior, makes me whole. Hallelujah, what a Savior.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, give unto us the increase of faith, hope, and charity, and that we may obtain that which you do promise, make us to love that which you command. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
O eternal God, our heavenly Father, who alone makes men to be of one mind in a house, and stills the outrage of a violent and unruly people, we bless your holy name, and ask that it would please you to appease the seditious tumults which have been lately raised up amongst us, most humbly begging you to grant us grace, that we may obediently walk in your holy commandments, lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty, and continually offer unto you our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving for these your mercies toward us. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
O most mighty and merciful God, to whom alone belong the issues of life and death, in this time of grievous sickness, we flee unto you for relief. Deliver us, we beg you, from our peril. Give strength and skill to your ministers of healing. Bless the means of cure, and grant that, perceiving how frail is our earthly life, we may apply our hearts unto that heavenly wisdom which leads to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
O Lord, our heavenly Father, the high and mighty ruler of the universe, who does from your throne behold all the dwellers upon earth, most heartily we beg you, with your favor, to behold and bless your servant, Donald Trump, our president, our Senate and representatives in Congress assembled, Philip Murphy, the governor of New Jersey, Tom Wolf, the governor of Pennsylvania, and all others in authority. And so replenish them with the grace of your Holy Spirit, that they may always incline to your will and walk in your way. Empower them plenteously with heavenly gifts. Grant them in health and prosperity long to live, and finally, after this life, to attain everlasting joy and happiness, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, the strong tower and refuge of your people, we entreat your favor upon the officers and all who are enlisted in the service of defense of our country. Ever spare them from being ordered into a war of aggression or oppression. Use them, if need be, as your instruments in the defense of our national life and liberty. By restraining, we beg you, the greed and wrath of man, that wars may cease in all the earth. Watch over also all policemen and law enforcement officers everywhere, especially Tim Richowski. Protect them from harm in the performance of their duty. We pray also for firefighters, first responders, and healthcare workers, who protect us and ours from all types of danger. Give these men and women the courage and skills to carry out their duties well and safely. When they must go into the face of danger, be by their side. Watch over their families, reminding them that those who go into danger are in your loving care. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Almighty and everlasting God, from whom comes every good and perfect gift, send down upon our bishops, especially Foley, Ray, and Chuck, and other clergy, and upon the congregations committed to their charge, the healthful spirit of your grace, that they may truly please you, pour upon them the continual dew of your blessing. Grant this, O Lord, for the honor of our advocate and mediator, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
O God, the creator and preserver of all mankind, we humbly beg you for all sorts and conditions of men, that you would be pleased to make your ways known unto them, your saving health unto all nations. More especially we pray for your holy church universal, that it may be so guided and governed by your good spirit, that all who profess and call themselves Christians may be led into the way of truth, and hold the faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, and in righteousness of life. Finally, we commend to your fatherly goodness all those who are in any ways afflicted or distressed in mind, body, or estate,
especially those for whom our prayers are desired.
For all those still suffering the effects of Hurricane Laura, and those suffering from the West Coast wildfires that are currently going on, for churches and our friends and families who own businesses that have been so greatly affected by the virus, especially Heather and Al, Larry, Mark, Roy and Bill, for Rachel and her upcoming surgery for the removal of tumors on one side of her liver, for Dominic, Al, Blitz, who is in the hospital, for Marion Petroni at the rehab center, for Audrey Cox, for Katie and her upcoming surgery, for Marge and her decisions with the doctors on the medicine she should be taking, and for all the students and teachers returning to school this week, and all those who are upon our hearts in the silence of these moments.
That it may please you to comfort and relieve them according to their several necessities, giving them patience under their sufferings and a happy issue out of all their afflictions. And this we beg for Jesus Christ's sake.
Amen.
Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give humble and hearty thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all men. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love and the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that our hearts may be truly thankful and that we may declare your praise not only with our lips but in our lives by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
Almighty God, you have promised to hear the petitions of those who ask in your Son's name. Mercifully accept us who have now made our prayers and petitions to you, and grant us those things which we have asked in faith, according to your will, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost, be with us all evermore. Amen.
The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Thank you.
As we consider, usually at this time, I would remind you to support your local parish. When possible, you can do that now by going to church. St. John's Church is now open for 8:30 and 10 o'clock services every Sunday, and you are welcome to attend. We do have certain restrictions up for the safety of everyone, including wearing a mask and keeping social distance. And we have the church interior set up to assist with that. But we certainly would welcome you to come and attend. If you are not able to attend and would like to support our ministry anyway, you may check out below our link to our church website, which has information on how you can support it. Or, of course, as always, you can write a check and mail it to the church. Also, while you're checking out below, please, if you are not subscribed already, please subscribe to St. John's by the Sea and click on the bell icon after you subscribe. Also, feel free to like the videos. That's always a nice thing, and it helps the videos to get promoted through YouTube.
Thank you for visiting St. John's by the Sea Church.
Did you get that one?
Yeah. Thank you for visiting St. John's by the Sea Church. This is Nolan Carter. Thank you for visiting St. John's by the Sea Church. This is Carter and not Noah. Only Carter. This is Carter and Noah. Thank you for visiting St. John's. Hi. Thank you for visiting St. John's by the